Hello, and welcome to another edition of the WWVC Frequency Comparator. And as you can see, the receiver is working. I'm injecting right now to my injecting 500 hertz. And the tone that you're hearing in the background is 500 hertz, and it's comparing it, and you can see it's quite stable other than the jitter, phase jitter, because the signal's coming in from various directions. And we've got nearly full scale on the carrier meter. It was full scale earlier. The signal propagation conditions are changing. Whoop, it just faded out. And now they'll change over to 600 hertz, and you'll see we'll have a disparity here. Now, if I got up and changed my signal generator, I would have another circle as it compared the WWV signal. However, I'm not going to jump up and do that. This is how they measured frequency on these, by the way. However, the receiver is still giving me fits, and we'll get into that in a second. So let me quiet things down here. Okay. We've made some improvements in the audio here. We got a time announcement coming up, and we'll cover that, how we did it, in just a minute.
18 hours, 40 minutes, coordinated universal time.
And you may or may not notice that the audio there was greatly improved over what it has been. The distortion is almost gone. And we accomplished that by putting a 0.001 capacitor across the 455 kilohertz IF filter, the ceramic filter. And the reason I did that is because that filter has a very, very, very narrow bandpass, and the specs are here. We have a 3 dB bandwidth of 1.4 kHz, a 6 dB bandwidth of 2.1 kHz. So by the time you've come out to 2.1, now most AM filters are narrow filters, considered 3 kHz for AM. So that was introducing a lot of distortion. It's got a 60 dB roll off at 5.3 kHz, so the skirts on this thing are real steep. So by putting a little bit of bypassing on there, we've opened up the audio bandpass a little bit, and it sounds a lot better. Now I'll have to ask the owner if he wants to stay with that or go back to the narrow bandpass. The design, according to the schematic, the design frequencies for this radio are as follows. For the 2.5 megahertz band, the local oscillator is supposed to be 4490, putting a first IF of 1.99 megahertz. The second local oscillator, 1.535, giving us a second IF, which is what goes into this filter before it goes into the IF stages, of 455 kilohertz. The second one should be 3.010, IF, blah, blah, blah. Everything ends up at 455 kilohertz. Now, the last two, the crystal, you notice we go 4, 3, 8, 13, and we drop back to 9 for the 20 megahertz band. That's because they are using the second harmonic of this crystal, 18.010, and that works out to, again, 1.99 for the first IF, 455 kilohertz for the second. That's with everything being on frequency. This receiver, the first local oscillator, which is crystal controlled, by the way, instead of 4490, is running 4490 336, 336 hertz off. Not bad. That puts our first IF at 1.990 336. Again, not bad. The 1.535 second local oscillator crystal is running 1.535 031, about 31 hertz high. Not bad at all. So it works out that on the 2.5 megahertz band, our second IF ends up being right on the money at 455 kilohertz. Things kind of fall apart here on the second band. Now, Up here, according to the schematic, this is a 3.010 crystal. Well, that's not what's in this radio. This radio is running 6.989.003. That makes my first IF from 5 megahertz 1.989.003. The local oscillator frequency subtracted from that, we end up with 453.972 going into that IF filter. That's 1.028 kilohertz low. Now, we only have a band pass on that filter of 1.4 kilohertz. Remember, without that capacitor, the band pass is 1.4 kilohertz at the 3 dB point. That just knocks the hell out of the signal. And you'll understand why I'm telling you all this in a minute. The 10 megahertz band is supposed to be 8.010 according to the schematic. It's 8.010.113. Pretty good again. Puts our local first IF pretty close. Puts our second IF at 454.856. It's only 144 hertz low. That's pretty good. That's pretty close to the center of the band pass of the crystal filter. Then we go to 15 megahertz. Instead of 13.010, we have 13.008.648, which puts our first IF 1.991.352, gives us our second IF after mixing with the second oscillator of 456.321 kilohertz. That's 1.3 kilohertz high. We've just about totally fallen out of our 3 dB bandwidth, and we're running up against the edge of our 2.1 kHz at 6 dB. We come down here to the 20 MHz band. We're running at 18.009.340. We get a 1.990.660. Going through the second local oscillator, we end up with 455.629. So we're about 629 hertz high. Again, not horrible under most circumstances, but remember, we only have a 3 dB bandwidth of 1.4 kilohertz. The 25 megahertz band is not working at all. Am I getting down? Let me lower this a little bit. There we go. The reason being, the schematic that I have only has 5 bands. It doesn't have the 25 megahertz band even shown on the schematic. This is a frequency that is hardly ever used by WWV. I think in the last 10 years they've broadcast on it a handful of times, maybe a dozen times for some test purposes. 99% of the time it doesn't even broadcast. They don't even broadcast there. But at any rate, the 25 megahertz band is present on the radio. The first local oscillator is running 11503. They're frequency doubling these because it's very hard to make crystals, or it was very hard to make crystals. Once you get up to 13 megahertz, you were starting to push the limits of grinding crystals. It became more and more difficult because the crystal's getting thinner and thinner and thinner. The grinding process becomes very involved. So they use a lower frequency and they use the second harmonic. Same thing here on the 25 megahertz band, 11.503.550, and they're frequency doubling that up to 23.007.100 is what it ends up being because of the frequency of the crystal. It should be 11.505 if you wanted a 1.99 first IF. On 25 megahertz, the correct frequency would be 11.505.23.010. We have 11.503.23.007, which means our first IF frequency ends up being 1.992.900. Our local oscillator, 11.535.031, you beat those two together, you end up with 457.869. That's 2.869 kilohertz high. 2.869. It's not even going to make it through that crystal filter. I have managed by tuning the IF, I've dialed the IF exactly into 455 kilohertz. This IF is based on the local oscillator frequency. This one, you adjust the IF cans. They're spot on. The receiver has about 1 microvolt sensitivity for a half scale reading on the signal meter, on the S meter, or carrier, they call it carrier meter. For a half scale reading, it's about 1 microvolt sensitivity right now on these 5 bands. When I switch over to the 25 megahertz band, I've got to inject from 1 microvolt, I've got to go to almost 200 microvolts to get a signal through it, because we're so far off the edge of the filter at this point, you can't even hear it. But surprisingly, these are very, very, you know, very sensitive. The sensitivity of this receiver is just astonishing. However, because of the offset and frequency, the audio is going to be quite distorted, especially on these two bands, on the 5 and the 15, because we're falling on the edge of the crystal filter, or ceramic filter, excuse me. Okay, what else have I discovered? Well, let me show you something. Here is our first, here's our local oscillators for the front end of the receiver. Easy for me to say. And you'll note there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 crystals. The sixth crystal, which would be 11505, if you do the math to make the 25 megahertz band work, doesn't exist on this schematic. This is obviously an earlier version. Down here we have trimmer capacitors that are hardwired across the crystal and should allow me to net these crystals in so that I can put that IF right in the center of the passband. By trimming these crystals, I should be able to shift the frequency and therefore shift that IF frequency right into the passband of that crystal filter, which is right here, Collins filter type J. And incidentally, here's our 1.535 kilohertz oscillator right here. The problem is, I can turn every one of these capacitors a full revolution, 360 degrees, and it doesn't change the frequency of these crystals as much as 1 hertz. It does, they have zero, absolutely zero effect. And I know somebody's going to say, oh, maybe the switch is bad. No, these are hardwired across the crystal, or through the crystal to ground here. The only switching involved is actually selecting which crystal capacitor pair you switch into the oscillator. These are hardwired according to the schematic, and yet when I turn these trimmer capacitors a full 360 degree circle, zero, absolutely zero effect on this thing. Now let's show you where those are. The crystals, the switch, and those trimmer capacitors are inside this can. The first local oscillator is here, the second local oscillator is here. So we have an RF amplifier, we have a first local oscillator, we have the 1.99 megahertz IF can, second local oscillator, crystal filter or ceramic filter, then first 455, another 455 amplifier, the second 455, and then we go into our detector circuits. Everything's inside of this box. We have an antenna trimmer for the RF section. We have an oscillator trimmer, an RF trimmer, and then there's the oscillator trimmers, are where my finger are right here. The screws are just behind the surface on this side. This enclosure is, you cannot open it when it's in the radio. This enclosure has to come completely out of the receiver to be worked on. I've actually had it out once. And inside of here is a second enclosure that contains the trimmer capacitors. They're sealed inside a second enclosure. I have verified that the wires are soldered to the crystal. I have verified that the other side of the capacitor is grounded as it's shown in the schematic. And yet they have no effect whatsoever on the circuit. I'm going to pull this apart one more time and see if it's going to be possible for me to remove this section and take a look at those trimmers. Now, it's impossible to fit anything else inside it. Fitting them outside would be an ugly mess. So it just may be a case of it has to be lived with in the condition it's in. But one more time, I'm going to take that out.
All right, we have the tuner section out of the receiver. And again, we have our antenna trimmers, we have our RF amplifier trimmers, and then we have our oscillator trimmers. And I'm going to take the screws out of the top and bottom, or the end and the sides of this thing, and we'll take a look inside.
I should add, the reason this is the second time I'm taking this out of the unit, originally, all of these screws for the trimmers were rubbing hard against the side of the case over here. Now this turns out is grounded to the case, so it really didn't matter. But at the time, I thought that perhaps because these were grounding against the case is the reason they weren't allowing any adjustment. And when I took it apart, I found out these two screws hold the assembly in, and there's actually an ovalized hole in here. It looks like it might have been done by hand at the factory to allow this thing to slide back and forth and center up, but they just never bothered. And all of these screws were really grinding. You could hear this grinding noise because they were rubbing up against the case here. But centering them up made absolutely no difference at all. It just acts exactly the same as it did before. So there you have it. There's the cover off. You can see it's compartmentalized between the different sections, very nicely isolated. There was some foam rubber in here originally that had just turned into dust, and I've replaced it with some more fresh foam that'll hold the crystals in place. Here you can see this is the hard wiring where those capacitors are absolutely soldered right to the crystal. And then all the switching takes place up here. Now, the reason I didn't go any deeper into this initially, and looking at it again, I thought maybe it had looked worse the first time, but I really am hesitant to go in here. I am going to, because this bracket is not only enclosing those capacitors down there, it's the rear support for the switch. The switch is an integral part of it. I'm going to have to disconnect everything from the switch, and I'm really worried about damaging that switch. It's just plastic. It's not even a phenolic or, you know, it's just something that's so easily damaged. I'm really, really concerned about taking it apart. What else have we got in there? Oh, I see. Yeah, there's a capacitor down there. Boy, this is going to involve a lot of disassembly. I'm wondering. No, I can't. You can see the capacitors are soldered right here to the chassis. There's a whole row of them right down the line. And then the other lead is soldered right here to the crystal. So it's not a case of the switch being dirty or the switch being non-functional. There. Give me a minute. I want to take a closer look. Okay, I've been examining this thing closely. We have some red Gliptol in here. Oh, incidentally, speaking of Gliptol, all of these adjustments were locked with Gliptol, this red fingernail polish looking stuff. Never, ever, ever attempt to adjust anything like this until you soak this in acetone
which is basically fingernail polish remover. If you don't want to run down to the hardware store, steal your wife's or your girlfriend's fingernail polish remover. And make sure you saturate these right in this area. Take a Q-tip, soak a Q-tip, and keep dabbing it until the glyptol starts to come off. Then you'll be able to turn these safely. If you try to turn these without releasing that glyptol, all you're going to do is break the screwdriver end off of this thing where it's slit for the adjusting tool. And that's another thing. Don't use a screwdriver. Use one of these adjusting tools that has the little piece of aluminum in the end of it here, and it slips over the end, because these will give up usually before you damage the head of the adjustment. You use a regular screwdriver, you're going to split these wide open and destroy them. But always, always, always soak them in acetone first. Okay, back over here. This glyptol here is on the screw that's holding the capacitor to this grounding plate or bracket or whatever you want to call it. And the other end of the capacitor is actually soldered. So this is not providing the ground, that's just mechanical mounting. This is the cold side of the capacitor. It's very firmly screwed down here. I know that's a reliable ground. I've checked it. I had those screws out and I socked them down as tight can be. It's threaded directly into this piece of metal. They're properly grounded. This is the other end of the capacitor. Now I've removed two of the crystals, the 5 megahertz and the 2.5 megahertz crystals. And we're going to put my capacitance meter across this thing. Now I've got a Boonton Electronics digital capacitance meter over there, and I've got a remote set up for it so that I can measure stuff in circuit. And as soon as I get the probe close to where I want it here, let's see, I've got to get it close to the device. I'm going to balance out for the stray capacitance. That's zeroed, that's close enough. 44 picofarad, I believe that's what the specs say there are. They say 7 to 45 picofarad. So let's try adjusting it and see what happens. I am going to put the screwdriver on here, and hopefully you can see the meter way over there. I'm assuming you can. So there's 24, 30, 42, 45, 49, 50, 60 picofarad, 70 picofarad. So they're not the value that the schematic says they are. It looks like they go from roughly 70 picofarad down to about 40 picofarad. But they are changing. Oh, there's 33 picofarad. And if I disconnect this, we should go pretty close to zero again. Yeah, 7/10 of a picofarad. It's not even a picofarad, so. I cannot explain why the oscillator is not netting in. And I cannot explain why it's so far out of frequency. Anybody have any ideas? I'd be glad to listen to them. I am at the point right now where I am at a total loss with this thing. That should be adjustable. Let's try another one. Let's try the next one down. There's 72 picofarads. Yep, they're changing. So the capacitors themselves appear to be working. And yet, I can turn that screw through its entire range and it doesn't shift the oscillator 1 hertz. So I don't know how to fix this. Okay, we have the tuning unit back in the receiver. And I've got the signal generator up and running again because I had to lower some of these turrets to get the unit out of the chassis. You have to screw them in a little bit to clear the notch in the chassis. This is truly an interesting receiver. even though I can't fix it, quote unquote, because I just don't know what else to do with it. There are no paper capacitors of any kind in here. Virtually everything in here is a ceramic disc capacitor. And you can see how they're all lined up straight, perfectly straight. All of the resistors, if I come down here, are in nice lines, nice rows. It's unusual in that almost every one of the terminal strips where the attachment is made to the chassis with a nut and bolt, they've also soldered it on many of them, which is kind of a nice touch. They have also, in a lot of areas, let's see if we can find one for you here. Oh, let me move the camera over here just a little bit. I hope this isn't too shaky. Right here, they have foregone any kind of lug whatsoever in many, many places and simply soldered directly to the chassis. Now, it makes a good ground that way, but it's just unusual practice to see as many components soldered to ground as this receiver has. They are everywhere like that. And yet, you find dozens, literally, of solder joints in here that at first glance don't appear to be soldered at all. It merely looks like the lead is stuck through the hole. But if you look closely, they are tack soldered into place. Now, I can't call these bad solder joints because nothing has failed. I have not found a single quote-unquote bad solder joint in this receiver. But there's dozens of them where the component is merely stuck through the hole and barely tack soldered to the edge. The minimal amount of solder they could get away with is what they've used on a lot of these connections. But again, none of them have failed. I can't find fault for that. This receiver is, you know, some, well, 60s vintage. You do the math. Long, it's an old receiver. Nothing has failed in here as far as a solder joint. But I can't fix it. I just don't know what to say. I'm going to return this back to the owner. I'm going to do a quick alignment because, like I say, I had to move some of these turrets. And I'm just going to tell them, pay me for the parts I put in it, the two bad tubes and the speaker. I have failed miserably on this thing. I can't figure out why the voltages are so high without adding a choke. And I cannot figure out why those tuning capacitors or trimmer capacitors in the tuning section up here don't have any effect. The only thing I can figure is there is so much stray capacitance in this thing that those trimmers are just being swamped. You know, they're not even being seen by the circuit because of the stray capacitance. And yet, how can this thing have been designed and gone out the door like that? I am baffled. This receiver is totally, I'm totally out of my depth here. I cannot figure out what's wrong with this thing. Why are the voltages so high? Did it leave the factory that way? Is it just such a good quality electrolytic that it never failed with an overvoltage condition in all those years? I can't tell you. Can't explain it. So I'm going to do a quick alignment, and I'll show you how sensitive the receiver is. Okay, we have our signal generator up here set to 2.5 megahertz, 1 microvolt output. So we'll come down here to the receiver. And I think you can see the signal meter here. And if I put this thing on 2.5 megahertz, we're just about half scale. And you can hear the signal in the background. It's readable. It's no 10 dB or 12 dB SYNAD, but it's there. And we'll go over here to 5 megahertz and plug in 5 on the frequency. 5 megahertz, there we have it. Half scale. We'll go up here to 10 megahertz. 10. Again, we have it. Plenty of signal there. 15 megahertz. 20. And if we go to like 5 microvolts, let's see here, amplitude 5, you can hear the signal cleans right up, all the hiss goes away, and we've got plenty of signal strength there. And normally WWV, I'm seeing, you know, almost full scale when it's being received here. So the receiver is working fairly well. Now if we go to 25 megahertz, and we'll dial that in, frequency 25 megahertz, that's at 5 microvolts. If I go back to 1 microvolt, come on, amplitude 1 microvolt, nothing, absolutely no signal there at all, just noise. And to get this up to half a scale, I've got to go to almost 50 microvolts. And I'm going to punch it right there now, 50 microvolts, and there's half scale reading. But it takes 50 microvolts versus 1 on all the other bands. It's simply because it's so far out of the pass band of the filter, and there's nothing we can do about it. I can't fix that. I don't know what's wrong with it. Obviously, the capacitors are working. The only way to fix that at this point would be either add external trimmers of some kind or get a crystal cut to bring it back in. Now, if they do transmit on 25 megahertz and the signal strength is loud enough, you'll hear it, but you know, it will never have the sensitivity of the other bands simply because it's so far out of the filter. In fact, the two best bands on this are going to be the 10 megahertz and the 20 megahertz, because they're both only a couple hundred hertz on off center of the IF filter, where the others are nearly a kilohertz or more off of the center of the crystal filter, ceramic filter. So I'm going to throw the covers back on this, and okay, we'll wrap
the
units
back together. We've squirted a little bit of chromate colored paint on there to cover up some of the rust, and we're coming up on a minute here. Right now I'm set up for 500 hertz, so we should see the Lisa Zhu pattern in a circle for the 500 hertz, and then when the minute tone comes on, that beep, which is 1,000 hertz, we should see a figure eight, because it'll be twice the frequency. There it is. There was our figure eight. And there's our Lisa Zhu pattern for the 500 hertz. Notice how much it's rolling right now? That's because of the signal fade. We're getting multipath and a lot of phase inversion. Right now we're on the 10 megahertz band. The 20 megahertz band has disappeared. The 15 megahertz has disappeared. And I suspect in another 20 or 30 minutes or so, I won't be able to receive the 10 megahertz signal either. We never get the 5 or the 2.5 megahertz this far east. But during the day, we do pretty well with the 20 megahertz and the 15 megahertz. So anyway, I hope he's happy with it in the state it's in. And as I said, I'm only going to charge for parts. I'm not going to charge for labor, because I don't consider this fixed. We should see the figure eight again. There you go. That's because their tone of 1,000 hertz for that minute marker is twice the 500 hertz that I'm putting in. Right now, that's a 600 hertz tone. And on the next minute, it'll alternate back to a 500 hertz. But I think the unit looks pretty good. It's functioning fairly well, considering the issues it has. Let's come over here and take a look. Okay, most of the rust is covered now. I didn't do the back side or the inside of the chassis. That would have taken days to take everything off the chassis and clean it up. And to be honest, it looks pretty good with the covers on. Okay, we're coming up on the minute.
At the tone, 23 hours, 24 minutes, coordinated universal time.
There was the figure eight, and there's the Lisa Zhu pattern. It's a circle because the frequencies match. And again, the rolling you're seeing going on now is because of all the multipath and phase shifting that's going on with that signal. If you watch the signal meter, you'll notice it's dropping out quite often. There it goes, and you see this roll at the same time. and it's probably because two signals are coming in at the same time and nulling one another, and they're causing that phase shift. You know, two different, the signals coming in via two different paths, as well as fading. So there you have it, back together, looking not too bad and working reasonably well. But I wish we could have figured out why that voltage was so high, and I wish I could have figured out why those trimmer capacitors don't work, but there's just apparently nothing wrong that I can find. So that's it. I'm the radio mechanic. Disappointing ending to this one, guys, but hey, you can't win them all. See ya.